Good evening and welcome to the West Jordan Planning Commission meeting for March 1st, 2016. We are almost all present tonight. We are currently missing Commissioner Sikorski. Jumping straight into our agenda, first, if you would kindly silence any electronic devices that you have, this meeting is being recorded for the public record. On our agenda, we have two consent items listed. The third item on our calendar, the third public hearing, the Cobley subdivision rezone, the developers asked us to table that to a date to be determined. So we'll also lump that into our consent calendar for three items on our consent calendar. Commissioner Pack.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I move to approve the consent calendar as you've mentioned.
Motion by Commissioner Pack, second by Commissioner Hansen. Any discussion to the motion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries 6-0. Which leaves us with one public hearing tonight, which is the Larson Meadows rezone. Rezoning 4.2 acres from RR5C and R110C to R110E. VP Holmes, Ty Brains is the applicant. Is the applicant present? Turn the time over to you.
Thank you. I'm Ty Vrains. You want me to state my address?
No, we've got that.
Okay. Excellent. Well, I am here for the Larson Meadows subdivision. And it is not a subdivision tonight, but of course a zone change application. So, to begin with, the property is located at 7953 South, 2700 West. It is across 27th West to the east from West Jordan High School. And this is where it is located. This parcel itself is a little more than 8 acres. We are interested and have under contract half of that, which is approximately 4.32 acres. And it is the eastern half of this property, and that is what is up for the zone change tonight. It is currently agricultural zoning, and we are requesting R110 with an E classification for the homes. Now, as you can see, this is the general plan for West Jordan City, and we are located kind of in the heart of medium density residential for the general plan. All surrounding, you know, the entire, all this color, kind of a beige-ish color, is all medium density. Now, within that medium density designation, it allows for 3.1 to 5.5 dwelling units per acre. Now, again, we're requesting an R110 zone change, which is 4.3 dwelling units per acre, which puts you right in the middle of medium density. The surrounding area is predominantly 10,000 square foot lots. That's kind of a generalization of what is in the surrounding area. And the E home size designation requires us to construct a minimum of total 3,000 square foot size homes, both for rambler and two-story. And I know I don't want to get too far ahead of anything, but just by way of information, the concept plan that we have, our lots range in size from 10,188 to 16,028, which gives an average lot size of 12,346. This is the concept plan that we have right now. This is Luster Point, and so the subdivision would enter from Luster Point and come down, and there are two stub streets that are located, and that is per city ordinance to have both of these stub streets for future development. And I know we're discussing zone change, so I don't know if any of this might be, again, a little bit too far ahead, but this is pertinent to the concept plan and how we have complied with the West Jordan Municipal Code. Title 14, Chapter 5, Section 5, and mainly the important parts are underlined in red here, which is streets and new subdivisions shall connect to existing stub streets from adjacent subdivisions. Stub streets shall be provided, which we have done. The platting of the sub streets will connect to future development, and access is recommended to be provided between adjoining neighborhoods and using local streets existing. This is a copy of a letter that that we sent out to some of the residents last week, just informing them. And this is just, it was by way of information, letting the residents know who we are and what we were attempting to do. We wanted to make sure and give them our phone numbers in case they had any questions. I didn't talk to many of the residents as a result of this, but I did talk to a few. A few did have some questions, and I know, hopefully we've answered those sufficiently for them. And I know that you all have seen the staff report, and I just was going to go through the criteria just very briefly. Criteria one, consistent with the purposes, goals, objectives, and policies of the city's general plan, we were found in compliance. Criteria two, compatible land use does not adversely affect adjacent properties. We were found in compliance. Criteria three, furthers the public health, safety, and general welfare of the citizens of the city. We were found in compliance. Criteria four, does not unduly impact the adequacy of public services and facilities. We were found in compliance. Criteria five, consistent with the provisions of any applicable overlay zoning districts. We were found in compliance again. So at this point, I'd like to open up any questions that there may be.
You said this, you're under contract with this property. Who did you sign the contract with?
Phyllis Larson. So it's owned by the Larson Trust, of which Phyllis is a 50% participant in.
Any other questions for the applicant? Quiet lunch tonight. Thank you, sir.
Okay.
We'll save you some time after the public hearing if there's anything from the public comment you'd like to address.
Okay, thank you.
Ms. Larson.
Thank you, Commissioner. So the proposed rezone is at 7953 South, 2700 West. A portion of the property, the north portion, is already zoned R110. The proposal is to just increase the size of the minimum allowed home size from what used to be 2100 square feet to 2400 square feet to the new E-sized home, which is 2400 square feet to 3000 square feet home size. The towards the south portion of the property is where the rezone will be zoned from RR.5C to R110E sized homes. The applicant covered the criteria, and he covered the proposal well, and staff is recommending that the Planning Commission recommend a positive recommendation to City Council for this rezone.
Any questions for staff at this time? Wow. So this was agendized as a public hearing to introduce our public hearing process. Anybody who would like to speak on this particular item is invited to the podium. If you would kindly give us your name and contact information, that way staff can follow up with you if there were any concerns there that they may be able to answer. You have 3 minutes to make your comments. You'll hear a little buzzer go off here, and then if you would kindly wrap that up to ensure that everybody has an opportunity to speak tonight, that would be wonderful. We did have one individual who filled out a card to speak, so we'll ask that individual to speak first, and that was Craig Nielsen.
Hello, my name is Craig Nielsen, and I live at 2591 Lester Point Way, which is the entrance into the new development. I have a lot of concerns, and I did talk with Mr. Rains and And he answered some of those questions partially to me. One of the biggest concerns I have is the safety issues with bringing all that equipment into that development through our subdivision. So they're not going to be coming in from 2700 West. They're going to be coming in through Angel's Landing. So the issue I see with that is there's children riding bikes, running around, doing their normal summer things. What happens if there's an accident? I don't think any of you want to have that on your conscience, do you? So that's a real concern for all of us, because you're looking at semis, cement trucks, dump trucks, graders, semis carrying transoms, all kinds of different big equipment coming through the neighborhood. And I think that's probably one of our biggest concerns. Also is the additional traffic once it's built, because there is no roads, or are no roads going out onto 2700 West. So at 12 homes, you're looking at anywhere from 24 to 30 additional cars that will be going through our neighborhood and that additional traffic. And I know that's a big concern with the neighbors that I spoke with. Also, we're a little bit worried about the dust, the noise, the hours of the construction. I know when I talked to Ty, he told me, you know, that they would water down the area out there to keep the dust down. If this does pass, that's going to need to be done daily, including Sundays. We have a lot of wind there. I also had some personal issues with the fencing at my property, that I don't know if I need to bring that up now or if I need to bring that up with him. But I would say the safety in the neighborhood is probably the biggest issue that most of my neighbors are concerned.
Thank you. Is there anyone else that'd like to comment on this item? Please.
My name is Arnold Ainge, and I live at 8039 Buena Vista Drive. And I have a question concerning along the last, well, let's see, get my bearings here. The last two homes in our subdivision, which is the Garden Valley subdivision on the west side, there's an irrigation ditch that goes down along there. And just would concerned about that irrigation ditch and what's the, if there's anything planned on that. It presently is an open irrigation ditch, and was in the past, the other was when Angel's Landing was constructed, they closed in the irrigation ditch and closed it up with piping. So that's our concern. And also, if they're not going to close it up, are they going to provide some kind of fencing around that and everything else to maintain the safety and integrity of the ditch, and also to eliminate other people coming in and becoming a problem with the ditch? That's all I have to contribute.
If I could point out just a little bit of clarification, the only thing that we're considering tonight is a rezone of the property. The applicant did provide us with a concept plan just to kind of give us a general overview of what might go into that space should the rezone be approved. But tonight we're not considering any aspects of the actual development. We're only considering changing the status of the property from its current designation to the R110E. That helps. That will come at a second phase, which will be noticed as well. Would anybody else like to comment? Very well. And we'll close the public hearing. And I don't know if there's anything specific you wanted to address at this point. Okay. Oh, great, thank you. That brings it back to us. Commissioner Green.
Oh, at the risk of being a royal pain, you'll notice from the question I asked the applicant earlier, we have a serious problem with this application. I believe that given the current state of the property, this application doesn't even have standing in front of us and is not proper. Let me explain why. As Mr. Raines explained the property is owned by a trust. The trustee is the only person that can sign for the property and is the only person that can contract the property. Phyllis Larson, that he mentioned, she may have an equitable interest in the property. She may be a beneficiary to the trust, but she doesn't have any right to contract the property and doesn't have any right to put the property under contract. If she's going to get part of the property from the trust, at least unless I miss some basic land, Mr. Thorpe can correct me here, unless I miss some basic land law, for her to be able to place half the property under contract, this property is going to either have to be subdivided or partitioned because the trust is the one that owns the property. The application in front of us was signed by Phyllis Larson as the property owner. She's got no legal standing to apply for this subdivision change at the present time.
Wait, so if I could ask a point of clarification there, is she the trustee?
No, she is not the trustee. I looked up last night, okay, and her brother is the trustee. So I'm very uncomfortable with us even proceeding with a zoning change until we have the true wishes of the true property owner on the record. For all we know, and I'm just going to speculate, I can speculate, but I'm going to just throw this out. For all we know, brother and sister are having a fight, and she said, fine, I'm going to sell half the property, and I'm going to do this, and I don't know that. And we don't know what Mr. Larson, who's actually the person who has the legal control over the property, to do. So until that's clarified, I'm going to say we don't even touch this.
I'll kick that over to city staff to comment.
Well, if Mr. Thorpe has anything to say, I don't know if the applicant wants to provide any points of clarification. Planning staff, I'm not aware of anything that we can contribute to this discussion at this point.
Well, I think this is a factual issue.
Very well. Sure. If you wouldn't mind giving us some additional context on that.
Is it okay if we respond
please
to your question? I'm Dennis Peters. I'm Ty Brain's partner. And Craig, you want to come up here? Craig is our agent, and this property was listed by the Larson Trust. We spent the last 7 months addressing the exact question that was raised by Mr. Green, by Commissioner Green, and as of this morning, Mark has signed a deed to deed half the property to his sister Phyllis. There have been some family issues that have been resolved, but we spent 7 months getting to the point that we could come here tonight. Mark was supposed to be here, but I don't see him here, and he had a flight to go out of town. So we can produce a warranty deed that Phyllis will receive from the trust, signed by Mark.
Commissioner Green.
But we don't have that on file yet. The application's still not valid on its face. What I'm going to do right now is I'm going to move to table this until the applicant can provide a true property owner with a copy of the warranty deed.
Excuse me. May I just add one more comment?
Please.
Mark Larson signed the affidavit of ownership for this application, yep, consenting to this application to be made, not Phyllis.
I would disagree with you. That's not in the package.
Phyllis. Okay. But Mark, we've met multiple times with Mark. If he were here tonight, he would verify what we're saying. She does have a beneficial interest in the property. The fact that she doesn't own it doesn't negate the idea that she has a beneficial interest in the property, as do we, having it under contract.
However, I'm going to interject here to do this correctly. City zoning ordinance, Title 15, requires all property owners on a project to sign the application. That did not occur here. She had no standing to sign that. To sign that says she's a property owner. She had no legal standing to do it. My perception is, and until we have a warranty deed and everything else, we can't proceed because the application isn't valid on its face. And so I've made my motion to table this until we can, until the property owner can amend the application and provide us the appropriate property owner documentation so that we're not proceeding on a project improperly. Okay, so that's my motion.
Motion fails for lack of a second. Scott?
Well, Mr. Chair, if I could maybe ask a few questions of myself. Is there, Mr. Thorpe, is there a distinction or difference between a recommendation and then a final action? Do we need to have that in order for the commission to forward any type of recommendation to the council?
Well, I think you can take that position. But I certainly agree with Commissioner Green that we've got a problem with the application based on what we heard here tonight. Beneficial ownership is not legal ownership.
So what I see is I'm not gonna be in favor of us forwarding a positive recommendation to the city council. So I guess from my perspective, we got a couple of options: table it or deny it, and start over. So I'm good with either one at this point.
Commissioner Hanson.
I am not in favor of the rezone because I do like the fact that it's 10,000 square feet. I do agree with Commissioner Green that we do not have a complete application due to the fact that looking at it, it's just Phyllis Larson is the only one whose name is on it. But I'm wondering if we could table this and just have it, if we're all in agreement with the zone as a consent item at our next council our meeting, as long as we have all the documentation.
Well, it sounds like a motion.
I would make that a motion.
I'd second that.
Okay,
so it's...
That we table this to our next meeting and put it on as a consent item as long as we have all the documentation from the trustee.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes, sir.
I just would like to offer another option. You could certainly make this a condition of your recommendation, so when it hits the city council, if it's not fulfilled, then your recommendation would be void.
Can we do that? Based on council's recommendation, it sounds like we could.
I'd be in favor of doing that.
Would you be interested in withdrawing your motion in favor of?
I'd be in favor of an alternative motion, as long as our planner here has the documentation before he takes it forward. I would be comfortable with that.
We would make certain that that documentation would be in that council staff report. There's no way we would forward that without that documentation.
So, yes, I would be in favor of sending it forward with that condition.
Okay, so then I guess I'll make a formal motion that we forward a positive recommendation to City Council for the rezone, as stated in the packet, with the condition that the appropriate deeding paperwork be submitted along with Council's packet for consideration.
Second that.
Motion by Commissioner Law, second by Commissioner Quinney. Any discussion to the motion? Commissioner Green.
I'll just speak against that one, just because I think that it in a lot of ways bypasses our process, because we should be able to see all of that We are the finders of fact here, and I don't think that we can appropriately find a fact when we're missing that substantial piece of the application. So I will be voting against that particular motion.
So noted. Any further discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed?
No.
Motion carries 5-1. That concludes our agenda for the evening. Anything else that we need to discuss? I would entertain a motion to adjourn.
Move to adjourn.
Anybody opposed to that? We stand adjourned then until March 15th, 2016.